This is Chicago. At the dawn of the 21st century, Chicago's media was dominated by a handful of major corporations. But a resistance movement arose to free Chicago's media from their clutches. One player in this movement is the Chicago Independent Media Center and its TV show, Chicago Independent Television. The Independent Media Center is a worldwide network of grassroots correspondents committed to using the tools of the media for promoting social and economic justice. You are watching this month's dispatch from the Chicago Independent Media Center.
Mr. Bishop, I want to use this picture on the front page of our next issue.
Oh, come now, Nancy. We can't print a picture like that.
The paper is read by people all over the city. Just think what a picture like that would do to the reputation of our newspaper.
I don't think we should hide things just because they're unpleasant. How do we stop things like this if we don't let the people know they're happening?
Hi, I'm Vermin Supreme, and whenever I'm watching some sort of moving images on a screen, it's indie media for sure.
Oil is life, and sometimes you've just got to grab it by the pussy. That's why we've teamed up with Big Oil and Big Banks to bring you the Dakota Access Pipeline. Once completed, it will transport shit tons of fracked crude oil to our refineries, where it will go on to fuel our commitments under the Paris Climate Summit to not give a shit about climate change. Safety is our priority. Accidents with toxic oil-carrying pipes like these only occur, well, like, most of the time. So where better to put one than under the majestic Missouri River, where a leak will only poison the water source of millions of people downstream. This glorious pipe dream will also create thousands of local jobs. For a few months, the only thing standing between the empire, the government, and total planetary habitat self-destruction is a rebel alliance of native tribes who've come together on the Standing Rock Sioux Reservation to peacefully protect the land and water for future generations.
Ew.
But don't worry, we're dealing with them in a culturally sensitive way. Enough wasting your taxes to invade countries on the other side of the world to get oil. This, folks, is the original American way, invading Native American lands to get stuff we want. Sure, we signed treaties to protect Sioux ancestral lands and burial sites, but that's never stopped us before. Remember that time we discovered gold in the Black Hills? The Treaty of Fort Laramie sure as heck didn't stop us from getting at it. We even left a thoughtful gift carved into their sacred mountain to say thank you and remind them of us forever. That's the spirit we're keeping alive today with the Dakota Access Pipeline, bringing you double the value by screwing both the past and the future in a single blow. Authorized by the Department of Homeland Invasions and Eco-Settle Pipe Dreams.
New developments. We have had aircraft flying over our camp for several days, different kinds of small charter planes and what looks appears to be helicopters, coming through at night. They mostly come at night and they have their lights off, which is dangerous to other aircraft. They're using the space illegally. They don't have any permits or permission to be using the airspace above federal tribal lands, so they're breaking the law to begin with. Last night, the new development was that there was an aircraft flying over camp, our encampment, from approximately 1:40 a.m. till about 2:20 a.m. this morning. Every 2 minutes on the dot, they were encircling the circumference of our camp and doing what we believe to be spraying chemical agents down on top of us. They are not reaching out to the sides where the police department has set up their barriers and their blockades, so we know that they are strategically placing these chemicals on top of us. This morning at 5:30, we came out because we heard the same aircraft passing overhead. It was verified to be a crop duster, and on the underbelly side of it, under each wing, there were two hoses which they used to spray down agriculture and poisons on top of different harvests that they're growing. These resources belong to our children. This water belongs to our children. This is our future. These kids need this land. They need this water. They need these resources, and they need us to stand and fight and protect.
Hi,
everyone. I'm not sure how long we're going to be able to keep this stream up, but looks like we got lucky for a second. So we're here on Highway 1806 in North Dakota. The main Ossetie-Sakowin encampment is right over there behind me. Earlier, so there's been some burnt out military trucks here on the bridge that were left there by the police to intentionally block people being able to advance up 1806 to their former 1851 treaty camp that was evicted on October 27th. So earlier today, when people brought in a semi-truck to try to pull some of the trucks out, police began firing tear gas. That attracted more water protectors from the main camp to the area. Pretty quickly, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of people have streamed in here. We've been out here for hours now. The sheriffs have been hosing people down with really cold water. It's probably like 20 degrees here right now. It's definitely below freezing. There's been, I've personally seen, I don't know, at least like 3 dozen tear gas grenades launched. We've recovered some of those and we'll be taking pictures of those. They've been firing concussion grenades, rubber bullets at people. And so I'm going to try to zoom in a little bit. You can see those lights are the floodlights the police have been using, both to keep an eye on the crowd and to sort of stop the visibility of people. But so, yeah, there's a crowd of, I would say, upwards of 1,000 people on this road right now, and then hundreds of police. But the police are definitely outnumbered here. And then you can see the police line sort of tapers off to the left here. There's a line of riot police stretching into the distance. Earlier, a group of water protectors had started to move around to try to get to the other side, maybe over some of the DAPL constructions taking place. Now you can see those lights in the distance are Humvees driven by the North Dakota National Guard with police inside. So there's a riot police line there in the dark by a frozen lake. And so those, well, you can't really see very well, but those are military Humvees over there. And some fires have been started up here. We're not sure why. We've seen vehicles. We have assumed police vehicles active in that area. So yeah, people have been getting doused with cold water and freezing temperatures for hours. Copious amounts of pepper spray and tear gas have been used.
Trying to stop the Dakota Access Pipeline.
You can't drink oil!
Keep it in the soil!
You can't drink oil!
Keep it in the soil!
Hey, can you tell me a little bit about why you're up today?
For our water, for our children, for the children that haven't been born yet. Water cannot defend itself. We cannot drink oil. Water is life. Showing solidarity with the Native Americans today. This is my brothers and sisters. We love you. We support you. At Sandy Rock, we will be there for you. I'm going out there to support you guys. So I'll be out there soon.
I'm here because water is life. And the JPL's got to go.
Water is life. 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 Water is life.
Can you tell me a little bit about what brought you up today?
Pipeline. It's going to go through us, and one day it will turn our water into oil. They're trying to make a profit out of our land. The Federal Bureau put us here on reservations. They promised never to go under them, but look what they're doing today.
We are Black Crow and Blackfoot, and so we partner with our other tribal families. Water is life. Without water, we can't do anything. We can't eat. Water, clean water. I think about my homies in Flint, Michigan. We all need clean water. So whether you join us or not, we're fighting for you, and it's something that we all should believe in. Water is life.
We have to protect our resources, and if you don't care about our resources, you don't care about our planet, and you don't care about our people. So you need to be out here and protesting.
Standing Rock Sioux Tribe here, Choctaw Nation, Alaska Natives, my brothers of Crow Nation, brothers and sisters here, because I pledged to all of you when I first ran for president that I'd be a partner with all of you in the spirit of a true nation-to-nation relationship. And I hope I've done right by you. We know the history that we share. It's a history marked by violence, and treaties were violated, promises were broken. Too often Washington thought it knew what was best for you. And that's a history that we've got to acknowledge if we are to move forward. And that's why I want you to know that I'm absolutely committed to moving forward with you and forging a new and better future together. It's a commitment to getting this relationship right so that you can be full partners in the American economy and so your children, your grandchildren can have an equal shot at pursuing the American dream. Few areas hold as much promise as clean energy. Up to 15% of our potential wind energy resources are on Native American land, and the potential for solar energy is even higher, and we have a lot to learn from your nations. Before we get at it, I want to close with this. I know you've heard this song from Washington before. I know you've often heard grand promises that sound good but rarely materialize. And each time you're told this time will be different. I get it. I'm on your side. I understand what it means to be an outsider. I know what it means to feel ignored and forgotten, and what it means to struggle. So you will not be forgotten as long as I'm in this White House.
His mouth, so it's not speculation, it's not people with an idea, it's a man who represents something that should never be represented in government.
The president-elect is a racist, and that's unacceptable. And everybody who voted for him voted for racism, and that's unacceptable.
Transgender, I go to Northwestern University, and because of Trump, I'm fearing that my rights are going to be taken away. But I want people to know that he can take our rights, but he can never take our identity.
All right, hey, thank you.
To stand with love.
Everyone is love. Here.
No hate, no fear. This presidency everyone represents everything no hate, I'm against. No fear. Hatred, fear, no racism, hate, no misogyny.
Everyone is welcome here. No hate, no fear.
Love, man, that's it. That's it.
Skin color, which is not very acceptable by the people who support Trump and Trump himself. I am also a queer man, and Trump has many, many plans to get rid of the laws that affect queer people. So that is why I am here.
I was kind of in denial after the whole election happened. I refused to look it up, and then I eventually had to go to work, and then everybody who was coming through there was like, you know this is real, right? And so I got on Facebook the next day, and one of my mentors from the past kind of did a call to arms, and I have to answer it. I can't, like, not do anything. Just because I voted and it went this way doesn't mean it's the end. I have to keep trying because I'm a citizen, and I have this right. And in other countries, people don't have that. I have to do my part.
Because we believe that brown lives, black lives, trans lives, women lives matter, and nothing will stop us from loving each other, coming together in unity. Yes! No hate, no fear!
Basically, we're here because Donald Trump is apparently the president-elect, and
that's kind
of
shocking.
A lot
right?
of us are feeling a lot of fear and pain because we feel that almost rejected from the country. Like, I was born here, and I, you know, it's the first time that I ever felt like maybe, you know, very unwelcoming. And so, I mean, we're here together, you know, to say that this is not okay. We don't want a racist, fascist, sexist president.
We just think that it's ridiculous that someone who's accused of sexual assault, of someone that can say such racist things, can become our president. So we're boycotting basically the racism, the bigotry, all of it.
What was your reaction to Trump being elected?
I cried first, a lot. And then I decided that I wanted to do something about it.
So what do you think? What are we going to do about it? Where do we go from here?
I think America just needs to realize how racially divided we are, how divided we are in terms of what we think is okay, or like how we want to treat other people. So the main concern is...
getting kind of congested moving forward.
Okay, yeah. The main concern is just treating people with human dignity. Like, we're not boycotting the democratic process. We're just saying that it's ridiculous that America can be so racist, basically.
Well, you know, we have an election process in place in this country that has existed for the entirety of our history, and while it's frustrating that this was the outcome, you know, that's how it works. I think it probably needs to be revisited. I think we probably need to change how it works, but I don't think it was a rigged election, and I'm here to let people know that even though Trump won through the mechanisms of the Electoral College, we still don't support those policies that he represents. He doesn't really represent America.
Flash. Humans are migrating en masse. Many in search of work and better circumstance. Many more displaced by wars and massacres. Predatory trade pacts, ethnic clashes, historical fractures, climate change impacts. Some call them refugees, others illegal immigrants. Whatever the label, there are more displaced people today than ever in history. Collectively, they form one of the world's largest nations, a flagless country of tens of millions, half of them children. So how is the world handling this crisis today? Surely the wisest, richest societies are responding in enlightened ways. We now invite three guests from such countries. First up, business magnate, presidential candidate Donald Trump.
My fellow Americans, our great nation's become a rotten dump. Thanks to that communist Obama chump, our southern border is an open door for any Juan to come. Illegals are pouring through the country, scooping all the dollars up. 12 million undocumented aliens, there's 4% of us, and 6 million are Mexicans. I'm told they're all drug dealers, rapists, and criminals, and hundreds are working in my Trump hotel businesses. I just don't get it. After all we've given them, we signed NAFTA, which trashed their economic system, put them out of work, and raised the price of tortillas. But despite our efforts, we can't seem to satisfy those taco-munching peasants. Let's bring in Katie Hopkins, a tabloid paper columnist. What's your take on immigrants? It's the day of apocalypse, and the EU is doing nothing to stop loads of unwashed droves from crossing over the ocean like cockroaches. They get on wobbly boats and drown, if we're lucky. Then the survivors arrive on Greek islands and head for this fine country, Great Britain, the whitened, I mean United Kingdom, where they swamp our local culture and welfare system. Feral migrants, spreading like the norovirus. We've had to put up miles of fences to stop the tide of outsiders. With jihadi names, weird clothes, and cruel customs, they're robbing us of our own country. Truly disgusting. Next up then, Australia's Prime Minister Tony Abbott.
Sounds like a bad problem you have there, but we don't have it. We've solved it.
You have?
Of course, we have all sorts of desperate people trying to get to our shores, but we got it all sorted.
How?
Well, tell us. We took this bloody UN Refugee Convention and chucked it in the dunny. To all asylum seekers, we shut our borders. We turn their boats back mid-voyage or bribe people smugglers to do it for us. And if anyone slips through to our shores after all that, we lock them up in detention camps on remote islands like Manus and Nauru.
For how long?
Indefinitely.
Heinous.
True.
Genius.
Definitely.
How do you get away with this?
It's easy as killing the ABC when both major parties are vying for the cruelest policy on refugees. And you ban anyone reporting on the camps and what goes down inside. Even rape and child abuse. Out of sight, out of mind. Tony, when I'm president in these parts, I'm gonna make you head of immigration. You're hired. To guard our border, we'll erect a huge rampart. And you know, when it comes to building walls, I got it down to a damn art.
Aussies, you're a shining beacon of vicious cruelty. If you can do it, by jingo, so can we. Quick, go, send our gunships and British Navy. Blow those sweaty Syrians straight out of the flipping grey sea.
Ripper, Katie, glad to be an inspiration.
Well, it's great to see such close collaboration between nations, but is it ethical? Let's pose that question to Mr. Moonseed from the NGO Real Humans Say Welcome.
Greetings, xenophobic pundits. My preaching from the pulpit today shall focus on the gleeful topic of oneness. Different cultures can bring new and positive customs. Great food, music, yoga, hot people, a melting pot of abundance. We need to open our borders and receive the magic. Let people roam the globe, choose love, not fear and panic. Unless, of course, they're trying to migrate to Atlantis, which is reserved for me, the highest race on the planet. Multiculturalism means the death of our fragile white race.
They're trying to wipe us out without a trace.
Only white countries are forced to mix with other ethnic types.
Dead right. If we get lax on immigrants, it'll be
white genocide.
Genocide? That's an interesting choice of expression. Didn't you yourselves migrate to the countries you now live in and push the locals out of their homes, imposing your own language, laws, and culture across their homelands?
Exactly. You saw how that went for Native Americans.
And for Aborigines. We are living proof of the danger of immigrants.
They'll steal the land we stole.
Invade our barbecue areas.
I'd rather leave than witness this.
Don't try to come to Atlantis, you barbarians.
How's it, my Chinas? Let's call an intermission. I've been listening in and it seems like it's time for one of my blixam interjections.
Bilderberg from the New World...
Ach, no introductions. I'm pleased to see that you're focusing your anxieties on the hordes of poor people trying to flee to your borders and shores, seeking sanctuary from scarcity, wars, and eco-catastrophes, rather than focusing on these migrants who cross all borders at will, overriding the laws of your countries, wreaking havoc, destroying thousands of local jobs and paying no taxes.
Corporations.
Corporations are people too, with special needs. Right now, while you scream about migrants and the refugees, you're about to see the signing of three giant corporate treaties. The TTIP, TISA, and TPP.
Free trade agreements.
Indeed. So free that they're being negotiated in secret.
The only details we've seen are thanks to these drafts leaked by whistleblowers and published by WikiLeaks.
Worried about migrants affecting the economy when they barge in? Wait till you see these trade pacts annihilate the job market, slash wages, and leave collective bargaining rights to started.
Worried about your sovereign laws?
These treaties will override them so foreign companies can make you a lawsuit target if your country ever threatens their potential margins.
Worried about guarding your culture from outsiders?
These treaties will extend copyright terms for decades after, siphoning knowledge out of the public domain and robbing you of your collective culture and scientific gain. And the spoils from all this plundering will be taken, not by local populations, but by foreign corporations.
We welcome that kind of immigrant here.
Here too.
We give them visas and let them leak the queue.
Faithful minions, I knew we could count on your commitment. Whoever said your immigration policies lacked compassion and wisdom?
Thanks to our guests for engaging in this conversation on the contentious issue of migrations on the planet. Mass exoduses like the ones we're witnessing cause real problems and tensions, there's no question. But as we've discovered, when it comes to managing borders and cultural habitats, these migrations are just one part of a larger pattern. Yet this is the part we're taught to fear and fret about. Why does that happen? By now we should have gathered this, when politics, lobbyists, business and media machinate to divert, scramble and mangle our view of the world we're inhabiting, we'd be wise to ask ourselves, whose interest does this skewed perception actually benefit? Someday, historians will look back and label this the age of mass displacements and assess how we handled it. Will they condemn our blindness or celebrate our vision and humanity? That's up to us in the present, where history is happening.
this is what they've been fighting over in Europe, is another corporate deal, the TTIP. And they've almost got it defeated. We want you to call Congress, 1-202-225-3121, and tell your congressperson no to the Trans-Pacific Partnership, no to dirty corporate deals, no to the corporations being able to regulate themselves, to get rid of regulations completely, to undermine our environmental laws, our workers' safety laws, our internet freedom. Did you know that they want to charge you every time you click on an article and send it to your friend? They want to charge you copyright charges. They want to charge you more for medicines. The TPP is not about trade. Only 5 chapters out of 29 are about trade. The rest of the chapters about how the corporations are going to take control of everything. They want to undermine your sovereignty. They want to instill a supranational court called the Investor State Dispute Settlement, where they can undermine our local laws, our state laws, our federal laws on the environment, on food safety. They want to do away with food inspections at the border. The TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, is a corporate coup. It is an absolutely, it's a boondoggle for the corporations. Do not buy the BS that they're selling you, that we have to have the TPP to trade with the 11 different countries in the Pacific Rim. We already trade with these countries. That is not what the TPP is all about. And the trade that we have with the countries, 90% of it is tariff-free. So that's not what the TPP is about. The TPP is about basically a one-world corporate government. They want to do away with our environmental laws, our worker safety. They want to offshore more jobs from America. How did NAFTA turn out for us? 1 million jobs were lost from NAFTA, and 1 million farmers in Mexico lost their land. That is what the TPP is all about. Consolidation, mergers, acquisitions, corporate rule, corporate power. That is what the TPP is about. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is a very dangerous agreement. It's not about trade. We're already trading with Japan. We're already trading with Vietnam. We're already trading with these countries. It is about the corporations getting everything that they want, every last dollar. Corporate greed, that is what the TPP is about. So don't listen to President Obama or Secretary Kerry when they say that this is about reaching out to these 11 Pacific Rim countries. That is a bunch of hogwash. We already trade with them. So we are for trade. We just want fair trade, not corporate rigged trade. And that is what the Trans-Pacific Partnership is. Corporate rigged trade, designed to do away with your democracy. Designed to undermine Congress, designed to undermine your state legislators and your city and local legislators. It is about corporate greed, period. It is a corporate coup.